Well, good evening. Thank you for coming back. Welcome to our second night of fun. If you'll gather your seats, I hope you brought your handout back with you. If not, find someone who is more studious than you and scooch closer. All right, I'm going to open us with a word of prayer, and then once again, we're going to hear another Bach chorale prelude from John Ahern. It's been a real treat, his willingness to play for us on this instrument. We'll have that a prelude shortly, but let me pray. Our Father, we do thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to be together. Thank you for all of these men that we've heard from, both last night and the work that John Ahern has put in. We thank you for his giftings and the work that he has done to bless us this evening. Bless both Ken Myers and John Hodges as they encourage us and exhort us and help us to see clearly and to listen with greater discernment and awareness this evening. Help us to delight in all of these great gifts, to not grow weary at our maybe inadequacies in understanding, but to be encouraged to press on and to go further up and further in the ways that you've called us to. So we do give thanks for their work and for the time that we can enjoy together, and we do so in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, please welcome John Ahern with a nice hearty clap. Thank you so much. All right, well, we have another hour and 10 minutes of just letting Ken Myers walk us through more of Luther's music. So without any further ado, please help me welcome Ken Myers back to the podium.
Thank you, John. So, John and I didn't plan to coordinate, but in the providence of God, he's played two Bach chorale preludes, not surprisingly, I guess, based on Luther chorale tunes, and this one in particular is based on a chorale melody, once again, first published by Luther in that famous 1524 hymnal. I can't tell you the German. This, like last night, like the Komm Heiliger Geist, this one is also a prayer to the Holy Spirit to come among us, and it's from a plain chant that I think dates back to about the 10th century, Veni Creator Spiritus. I don't know if Bach uses it in one of the Pentecost cantatas. I should know this. I don't think he does. I know there are a couple of organ works. But again, it's a wonderful example of how Luther grabbed all the good stuff. You know, there is an apocryphal statement attributed to Luther, why should the devil have all the good music? And people often said, that was Luther's justification for stealing all those drinking songs from the pub. If he did say that, and I don't think it's ever been documented that he did, if he did say that, it would be more likely that he had the Pope in mind rather than some tavern master. And so, because he certainly plundered all the music that he had learned as a monk, chanting, and that was one that would have been chanted, particularly on the Feast of Pentecost. So last night we sang, O Lamb of God, Most Holy, and I asked how many of you knew when Bach uses that. Somebody tell me, I'm sure someone here knows, when Bach used that chorale melody. Someone knows? Yes. No. It's in a place, it's kind of hidden away, in a way. It's actually in the very first section of the St. Matthew Passion. And we're going to listen to that first chorus, part of the first chorus, in a minute. The St. Matthew Passion is a huge work. It has three choirs, and two orchestras. And the opening chorus is a dialogue between the two choirs. And the words, one choir sings, "Come, you daughters, help me to lament. See," and then the other choir says, "Whom?" And then the first choir says, "The bridegroom, see him." "How?" "Like a lamb." "See what?" "See his patience." "See where?" "Our guilt." "See how," and then they sing together, "see how from love and grace he bears the wood of the cross himself." Depending on how fast it is taken, this runs from about 6.5 minutes to, I don't know how Helmut Rilling or some of those old guys, it might have taken a half an hour to sing, I don't know. But we're going to listen to the first few minutes. But what happens is while they're batting back and forth these questions, building a sense of a kind of intense sense of the drama that's about to take place as the story of Christ's arrest, trial, and crucifixion is about to be told in music. As they're in the middle of this, suddenly, in a sense, over top of all of the tumult going on, you hear a soprano, and usually sung by a boys' choir, singing that chorale melody we sang last night, the same text, O Lamb of God, O Lamb of God, innocent, slaughtered on the beam of the cross, always found to be patient, no matter how much you were despised. This is a literal translation. All our sins you have borne, otherwise we would have to despair. Have mercy on us, O Jesus. Now, the thing to keep in mind is when the St. Matthew Passion was first sung, is everybody who heard it would know that music because they'd probably sung it most Sundays for since the 1530s. Not that everyone there had lived since the 1530s. So for almost 200 years, that was sung at the near the end of every Eucharistic service. So it would have been profoundly evident to everyone that this is the story that is finally described in our partaking of the Eucharist, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So we'll listen to the first 2 or 3 minutes, but listen, I'll cue you in when you can hear, and I chose a recording where the boys' choir is pretty evident. Not all recordings have good acoustics that way. Here it is. Oops, there we are. See whom the bridegroom, see him how like a lamb. Here they come, ready. They sing that one line and they wait, they come back and do the second line. Okay. It feels wrong to stop that, but we will. Sorry, Sebastian. Part of what I'm trying to do in these two lectures is to explain how we got Bach. Bach is almost universally regarded as the greatest composer in the Western tradition. How did he arrive? And as I tried to begin to explain last night, he grew up in an ecosystem that was really friendly to his particular mode of imagination. He's unimaginable apart from the liturgical tradition that Luther had sustained, and Luther's own work borrowed heavily, as I outlined a little bit last night, and we'll describe more tonight, from what Luther himself had inherited from the pre-Reformation, from his experience in the pre-Reformation church. Luther borrowed lots of music from the Gregorian chant that preceded him. As I mentioned, the chorale prelude that John played earlier was based on a plain chant of Come Holy Spirit, Veni Creator Spiritus, Come Holy Spirit Creator, Come Creator Spirit, I guess that would be the best way to summarize it. So he took a lot of those early hymns. They were really hymns, they weren't part of the Mass, they weren't a regular part of the Mass, and Germanified them. He adapted the melody a little bit to make it a little more fitting for the German language, and then often took just, I think in the case of that Veni Creator Spiritus, I think he just translated it into German, a metrical German to be sure, but he didn't add a lot. He also, the piece that we just listened to was used in place of the Agnus Dei, which was the last part of the Mass, a part of the ordinary of the Mass, sung during communion. And this was not one of his, but one that he championed by Nicholas Decius. He regularly took the text or the spirit of the text that he had inherited from the Mass and adapted it. On your handouts, you'll see, I'm sorry, I forgot to paginate these, but there's a page that has traditional Kyrie, German Kyrie, traditional Gloria, and then a German Gloria. If you pull that up, you'll see, and there were multiple versions in German of the Gloria. I've given you English translation of the German. The traditional Kyrie is quite simple. Lord have mercy upon us, Christ have mercy upon us, Lord have mercy upon us. It's pretty spare. Usually each of those lines is repeated three times, so it's not just three lines, it's nine lines typically. Well, there were lots of settings of what came to be called German Kyries, where instead of just a plea for mercy, you get a theology lesson, which is a good Lutheran practice. So you have, again, you have a threefold Kyrie, but it's not just Lord, have mercy upon us, it's Kyrie, which again is the Greek word for Lord. But it's Lord, God, Father in heaven above, great art thou in grace and love of all things, the maker and preserver, eleison, eleison. That's the Greek for have mercy on us. Then the second stanza, Kyrie, O Christ, our King. Just as in the traditional Kyrie, it's Christe, Christe eleison. Now you have Christ specifically addressed in the second stanza. But instead of just saying, Christ, have mercy upon us, it's Christ, our King, salvation for sinners thou didst bring, O Lord Jesus, God's own Son, our mediator at the heavenly throne. Hear our cry and grant our supplication. Eleison, eleison. Have mercy, have mercy. And then finally, the Holy Ghost is addressed in the third stanza. Kyrie, O God, the Holy Ghost, guard our faith, the gift we need the most. Do thou our last hour bless. Let us leave this sinful world with gladness. Eleison, eleison, amen. This is very typical of Luther's appropriation of the traditional structure of the Mass, but infusing it with more theological teaching, more theological information. He didn't want people to accept the experience of worship as just kind of a mindless ritual they go through, because the clergy at the front are doing all the heavy lifting, and they're, you know, it, and you know, just showing up is good enough. He really wanted people to understand the gospel. Let me play. I couldn't find any recordings of some of the German curias from the period. I did find a reconstruction in the spirit of a 16th century curia. A bunch of hardy Lutherans got together and sang actually this text, which is written by one of Luther's contemporaries, rough contemporaries. There are a couple minor differences in the translation from the German, but you'll get a sense of the spirit of it. And you'll see how they're singing it. This is a congregation singing, but you'll see that they've kind of split up the congregation to make it somewhat antiphonal. Here's what that sounded like. Oops, I'd faded down to, I'm sorry. Wondered, that's an awful long pause. Here we are. Again, that's a kind of a reconstruction. It's a little bit like visiting Colonial Williamsburg and seeing people act out. So we're not really sure that was the... although, again, I couldn't find from the website whether or not this was based on a traditional melody, but it sounds about right. There's a much more famous setting of the Gloria that was used in a lot of Lutheran churches that Luther promoted. And again, this is the Ordinary of the Mass, Glory be to God on high and on earth, peace, goodwill towards men. I won't read the whole text. This is still sung in many churches, including my church. We sing this every Sunday. The German version, and again, you'll see the text was... Luther collaborated with Nicholas Decius, who wrote the setting of the Agnus Dei we listened to earlier. And again, it teases out more theology than is present in the Gloria. I mean, the Gloria, as we have inherited it, already has a lot of theology in it. Luther is particularly interested in making sure people understand the plan of salvation, how salvation is actually achieved. So instead of just saying, glory be to God on high and on earth, peace, goodwill towards men, which is good text. I mean, after all, angels sang it, so it must be a good thing to sing. To God, in the Lutheran version, To God alone on high be glory and thanks for his mercy, since now and forevermore no harm can touch us. God is pleased with us. Now there is great peace without cease. All feuds have now an end. And it goes on. But it pretty much follows the logic of the traditional Gloria. Now, this is actually a tune that was set many, many, many times. I'm going to play the beginning of a four-part setting of it, and then I'm going to explain a little bit about where Luther got this melody. Okay, I'm sorry I don't have a score for this. I hadn't thought that, I wasn't sure we would have time to listen to this. Now, interestingly, that melody, I did some research and figured, I wonder if that's one Luther wrote. Well, it turns out that he's just stealing stuff all the time. I mean, the lawyers would have been really busy. It's the intellectual property rights thing. This is such a mess. I'm going to play, in Luther's day, there were many, many, many different settings of the Mass, chant settings. There were some more richly composed settings. Here is from one of the Masses that was, I have a small book of, I don't know, 10 or 12 of the most significant Mass settings, and this is actually the first one. It's Missa Lux et Origo. Listen really closely. I'm just going to play Gloria in Excelsis Deo et in terra pax omnibus boni voluntates, which is glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. And listen when they start singing et in terra pax omnibus. This is a group of monks chanting this. If I could turn it up again. Oops, sorry. I used to be a disc jockey, believe it or not. Now. We just heard da 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 da. Let me play the plain chant again. Note for note, he stole it. The lawyers, again, they're going to have a field day with this. Now, again, Luther had probably chanted that hundreds of times. So he realized, you know, we're going to... And the congregation in his church had probably heard it dozens of times. So he's establishing continuity with the pre-Reformation church. He's radically challenging some of the theology, but he's holding on to, first of all, it's a great tune, but also it has this long-standing venerability, if you will. Now, I'm going to play. By the way, this tune shows up in Mendelssohn's oratorio Paulus, the second movement of that. It's right at the beginning of his oratorio about the life of Paul. Let me play that, just the beginning of that really quickly here. Mendelssohn used a lot of Lutheran chorales, and this is right at the beginning of that work. I want to play one of Bach's appropriations. He wrote, I think there are probably more chorale preludes for organ written on this tune than any of the other tunes. And again, it's because the pieces like the ones John played for us were often played as preludes before a worship service. They weren't heard in concert. They may have been. But so on Pentecost Sunday, the organist sits down and he's anticipating what hymns are going to be sung. And on Pentecost Sunday, you always sing that hymn that John played. So as a result, there are lots and lots of chorale preludes based on this German Gloria. Let me play the beginning of one of them. Oops. Okay, not even a minute long. There are some that are a lot longer. One of the more interesting uses of this shows up in a cantata that he wrote for, I think this one was for New Year's Day, I should know offhand. But it's an amazingly celebratory tone to it. But that melody doesn't show up until a little bit later, after the party's gotten started and all the fireworks have gone on. We'll just listen to the first minute or two of this. This is actually for Ascension Day. They're celebrating the Ascension of Christ. So it's a party, but the Gloria is embedded right in the middle of a text which is singing about Christ's ascension. It talks about Christ has made this journey to heaven, anticipating my own journey to heaven. It's what the text is that the choir is singing. Okay, let's move on to one more thing, and then I'm going to stop playing DJ and give you a little more history about Luther's experience. I wanted to, you have also one of the pages, you have a full page of Luther's paraphrase of the Lord's Prayer, Vater unser in Himmelreich. Let me play you, and you actually have, I forgot, we actually have the music for this, and if we have time, we may sing this, but I want to get through listening to a couple of the other examples. So you can see this hymnal, Luther had 9 stanzas in the hymn. Not many modern hymnals have room for 9 stanzas, or congregations patient enough to sing 9 stanzas. But you'll see what he's done. If you look at the text, it's easier to read with the text only. Our Father, who in heaven who art. And then instead of hallowed be thy name, it's who tellest all of us in heart, brothers to be, and on thee call, and wilt have prayer from us all. Grant that the mouth not only pray, but from deepest heart, oh, help its way. Hallowed be thy name. And then he goes on and gives a 7-line or 6-line summary of the significance of that invocation. Thy kingdom come, and then 6 lines about that. Thy will be done, 6 lines about that. This is like a little sermon about the Lord's Prayer. This is one of the hymns that are often referred to as one of Luther's catechetical hymns. He's taking the basic elements that are historically part of the Christian liturgy and, again, expanding on them so people will understand the truth of the gospel and what their obligations are as believers. Here's the melody, and you can follow along. I think the melody, the rhythm's going to be a little different, but you have the music for Our Father, Thou in Heaven Above. Here it is, as originally sung in German. Okay. So again, this would have been sung many, many, many times. The Lord's Prayer is sung at almost every service. So that's Luther's own setting. Not that he insisted you have to sing my setting, but it was popular, and there are lots and lots of settings of this. Here again, one of the Bach organ settings. He's introduced that main introductory theme 4 times at different octaves. Now he's getting into the second line, the second phrase of the hymn. Okay. This could go on forever, sorry. Okay, now I wanted you to hear that tune to get it in your head. No, it's a lot to ask fast. One of the most amazing uses of this melody, which again, as I said, would have been incredibly familiar by the time Bach is writing cantatas in the 1730s and 20s, 30s, and 40s. Everybody knew that tune. So Bach is writing a cantata to be sung on the 10th Sunday after Trinity. And the biblical readings for that day, the gospel reading for that day is from Luke's gospel, chapter 19, right after the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And then Luke tells us about Jesus weeping for Jerusalem because he's anticipating the destruction that's going to happen. So Bach writes a cantata to be sung that day, and the opening chorus, let me read the text to the opening chorus. Take from us, Lord, you faithful God, the heavy punishment and great distress which for our countless sins we deserve to have all too often. Protect us from war and costly times, from plague, fire, and great misfortune. So he's taking a text, and I can't remember who wrote this. This was actually Martin Mueller, who I think was, I think he may have been a Lutheran preacher, pastor, who wrote that text. The gospel reading that they're about to hear is Jesus weeping over Jerusalem being judged. And they're Bach is basically anticipating that reading being heard, and he's saying, you know, we need to pray that we're not going to be judged the way Jerusalem was. He writes this opening chorus, which is a unique sound coming from Bach's pen, I think. I don't think there's anything that sounds quite like this in Bach. And in the middle of an incredibly tempestuous sound that's, you feel like danger's on every side, you'll hear one section of the choir singing the tune that we just heard, singing the text of the Lord's Prayer. So let's listen to that. Singing this invocation that God not punish us horribly like we deserve. Stop there. Now, some of you probably heard that each of the vocal parts that's coming in, I can't remember if that main slow version of the melody, I wasn't paying attention to see if it's the soprano or the altos. I think it was, do you think it was the altos? Yeah, that's what I thought. So the sopranos and tenors and basses coming in are also singing little elements of that melody. So it's there, it's kind of twisted, but it's straightforward and confident as the altos are singing it. So again, what the congregation would have heard would have been, first of all, this scary instrumental music, which sounds like everything's falling apart, and very dissonant, edgy vocal lines in three of the parts, and then one of the vocal parts is singing confidently, the melody that they'd sung the Lord's Prayer to for hundreds of years. So anyway, that's a wonderful example. And if Bach couldn't have gotten away with this if Luther hadn't paved the way by establishing traditional tunes that were tied to traditional to particular theological themes and particular texts. Not to mention the fact that he some of those tunes he plundered from the pre-Reformation liturgy. Okay, so let's do a little more history. Last night I said that some people think that what Luther did was basically just grab a bunch of drinking tunes from the local tavern and adapted them. As I said, that's deeply wrong. He never adapted. There was only one instance where he took a secular song of any kind and put a sacred text to it. And within a few months, and he did it not for use in the church, but for use in the family. And within a few months, he thought, this just doesn't work, and I found a different tune. And the tune that he ended up using to that text, the sacred text, is we know as Von Himmelhoch. From heaven high I come to you. It's a Christmas tune. And I think he wrote the one he ended up using. So there's only one instance where he, just for a short period of time, borrowed from a secular melody, thought it didn't work. Besides, there were so many other good melodies that he was aware of that were part of the tradition before that. Carl Schalk, who has written a lot about Luther's music and theology, writes that Luther, quote, saw the great dignity of the royal priesthood as a significant warrant for encouraging the active participation of all, congregation, choir, presiding and assisting ministers, composers, at the highest level of their abilities. Precisely because the church is a royal priesthood, we have to be on our best, we have to give our best. Luther never lowered his standards to be more democratic. He never abandoned beauty or order in instituting his reforms. Now, it is true that Luther and his colleagues did draw on musical traditions outside the church's liturgy for some of the building materials of some of the hymns that they introduced. But one thing that we need to keep in mind that what we think of today as popular music had no real equivalent in the 16th century. Often people say, well, there was popular music in those days. Well, let me describe what people would have experienced outside the life of the church. In the book, The Whole Church Sings, with which Robin Lever has written about the rise of congregational singing, he pointed out that the tradition of folk music and the place of folk music in the lives of folk in pre-modern societies is hard for people of the 21st century to fully comprehend. Folk music and what we think of as popular music or popular culture are not really dynamic equivalents. What's especially strange to us is the social and communal dynamic that music exerted. As Lever writes, quote, no aspect of life, serious or frivolous, no detail of news, national or local, no human emotion, euphoric or dysphoric, no natural event, phenomenal or catastrophic, would be allowed to pass without becoming the subject of vernacular songs. The music of today's popular culture, conveyed individually to our ears through electronic ether by various technological toys, has effectively eliminated this long tradition of vernacular folk song. I mean, so when we hear about some tragedy or some frivolity, I mean, nobody's written a song yet about Britney Spears' problems with her dad. Well, maybe they have, but what Lever's suggesting is every important aspect of life that had any kind of moment or even something that could have been relatively trivial, somebody would write a song about it and pass it on through word of mouth. Lever says, of course, we sing along with our MP3 players to the latest popular songs that express human aspirations and emotions, but the transmission is top-down and immediate, the opposite of the bottom-up communication of the older folk song tradition, in which melodies were slowly honed and modified and texts were developed and expanded by oral transmission from person to person and group to group, close quote. Now, Lever points out that there were at least four different musical sources outside of the church that Luther could rely on for models of musical expression in German rather than the Latin of the church. Remember, the big thing he's trying to do is, we've had music in Latin in the church for hundreds of years. I want German, the German language, to be sung. He didn't get rid of Latin entirely, but he wanted the German language to be sung and heard. And there were four sources that he could rely on. As Lever writes, for good pedagogical reasons, Luther wanted to establish the practice of congregational singing by building on what was already known to the people. But, as he points out, the people had access to more than rowdy drinking songs. Four sources of vernacular religious songs, religious music that was available to people outside of the worship life of the church. Often simple folk songs, the first category was just simple folk songs, many of which had religious texts. And there was also the music of the so-called Meistersingers, the master singers. The Meistersingers are a very interesting lot of what we might think of as troubadours. Before there were master singers, there were the minne singers, medieval troubadours. And minne is the Middle High German word for love. These were the love balladers of their day. The minne singers were skilled singers of poetry expressing the ideals of courtly love. From their tradition grew the groups that were called Meister singers or master singers. Lever points out that they were established in major German cities in the early 14th century, flourished in the 16th century, continued well into the 17th century and beyond. What's interesting about the Meistersingers, these troubadours, it was more like, well, let me read what he says, like the merchant and craft guilds, which set the standards for membership and in return preserved the rights and privileges of guild members. The Meistersingers also formed themselves into guild-like societies that drew up specific poetic and musical rules for the creation of Meisterlieder, the master songs, and similarly directed how such Meisterlieders were to be performed by the Meistersingers. This is not a free-for-all where anybody who wants to write music just got to, you know, find an agent, you know, record it, and get a recording out. This was seriously disciplined practice, and if you had to write in certain ways. Now, Lever also points out that from the beginning there was a strong religious element in much of the poetry of the Meistersingers. Many of them thought themselves at continuing the expertise demonstrated by King David in the biblical Psalms early on. Now, as the tradition expanded, the topics for poetic exploration and musical expression expanded, but religious themes were still a major focus of the Meistersingers. The poetic and musical form that they used was what was called bar form. And unfortunately, that term bar form may be the source of the fact that people think Luther got his music from bars. Well, first of all, they wouldn't have been called bars in Germany. But bar form is a term that has an obscure background. It's probably derived from the art of fencing, where a barat was a well-aimed thrust. And thus, the Meistersinger context was upon skill both poetic and musical. This wasn't drunken music. This was very deliberate and shrewdly written music that had the barat. The bar form included a particular structure of the verses. So what would be called AAB, poetic form. So you would have one line of music, and then the second line of music would be exactly the same as the first line, and then there'd be the third line, which would be different. The melodies of the Meisterlieder were almost exclusively orally transmitted, so we don't have a lot of them. They didn't get them published, but from the melodies that are known, they were very carefully crafted, just like the poetry that they accompanied, and most of them were in this AAB form, which we call bar form. Now, in addition to these Meistersingers and their songs, there were also sets of things called ballads, which in early 16th century Germany were in some ways more like CNN than MTV. They were quote, written on all kinds of subjects, but tended to have a notable news element. Though from the perspective of the 21st century, a good many of the ballads appeared to be recording history rather than current events. The art song of the Meistersinger tradition was the model for popular ballads that used bar form, significantly simplified. After Luther's protest in 1517, there were religious ballads, which was a notable part of the wider cultural tradition, and became increasingly more and more polemical as the Reformation debate became more and more intense. Again, these are, in a sense, religious songs, not sung in church, sung in German, but part of a kind of folk tradition. And then finally, there was a fourth category. We had folk song generally, the Meistersinger's music, the ballads, and then a group called the Leise, or Leise, L-E-I-S-E. I don't know German well. I think it's Leise. Is it Leise? Okay, this is L-E-I. Yeah, Leise. Leise, is that what you said? Okay, the term comes interesting from the word Kyrie eleison, which is the Greek Lord have mercy. There were a lot of religious songs that were sung in processions or funerals or pilgrimages or liturgical dramas, and they often ended with either saying Kyrie eleison or Kyrie eleis or Kyrie eleis or Kyriel, shortened forms of the Kyrie eleison, and they were called Leise? Leise? That's what we agreed. Okay, thank you. So this. And there were lots of these around, and Luther was familiar with a lot of them. So he had a lot of material to draw on that were sacred texts, religious texts, pious devotional texts in some instances. They just weren't being sung in the Mass. They weren't being sung as part of the liturgy. So his radical decision was to adapt these to make them appropriate for congregational singing. Robin Lever insists that while Luther adapted religious folk songs for use in worship, quote, the conclusion that Luther was totally open to the use of melodies associated with overtly secular texts in evangelical worship cannot be supported, either by specific statement of the Reformer himself or deduced from his practices as a writer of hymns. Rather, quote, most of the music Luther provided and promoted for evangelical worship was based not on worldly ballads, but rather on the chant of the church. It much, much more important to Luther's own liturgical musical project than these religious folk songs was his knowledge of and experience with the two dominant musical forms within the liturgy as he had grown up with it. Gregorian chant, with a very simple melodic purity of a single voice or voices in unison, and polyphony, complex musical forms with multiple voices united, sometimes with a sense of mystery. Luther had sung Gregorian chants since he was a schoolboy. Although he became a monk in 1505, he was, Lever writes, completely immersed in the daily pattern of worship of the monastic community before that. which involved extensive singing of Gregorian chant. As a monk, he was now exposed to the full extent of the daily offices throughout the church year. He had to sing all of the offices every day. Now, offices aren't a room where people have a desk. The offices were the times of prayer, and there were eight times during the day, eight offices of prayer, one on average every 3 hours, in which the monks gathered to pray, and their prayers were always chanted. And there was a huge body of chants that were part of that daily prayer. Imagine you're going to be chanting, I don't know how long the offices took, 20 or 30 minutes at the minimum, I would assume. And there were psalms and hymns and responsories, and they all were specific to particular time and season. They sang through the whole of the Psalter every week. And then after his ordination in 1506 or 1507 as a priest, his experience of the chants of the Mass was intensified because now he had to sing the gospel and epistle lesson at every Mass, and as well as other parts of the liturgy that were assigned to the priest. So hours and hours every week from the time he was a kid, because he went to the Latin school sponsored by the church in, I'm blanking on the name of the town he was in. So Luther loved chant deeply. In 1542, he edited a book of chant melodies with biblical texts that differed from the traditional settings. In the preface, he explained, quote, "We have collected the fine music and songs which under the papacy were used at vigils, masses for the dead, and burials. Some fine examples of these we have printed in this booklet, and we, or whoever is more gifted than we, will select more of them in the future. But we have adapted other texts to the music so that they may adorn our article of resurrection instead of purgatory with its torment and satisfaction, which lets the dead neither sleep nor rest. The melodies and notes are precious. It would be a pity to let them perish. But the texts and words are non-Christian and absurd." Tell us what you really think, Martin. "They deserve to perish. The papists also possess a lot of splendid songs and music, especially in the cathedral and parish churches. But these are used to adorn all sorts of impure and idolatrous texts. Therefore, we have unclothed these idolatrous, lifeless, and foolish texts and divested them of their beautiful music." Why should the devil have all the good music, right? "We have put this music on the living and holy word of God in order to sing praise and honor it. We are concerned with changing the text, not the music." This is relatively late, 1542. Luther loved chant, and he also loved polyphony, complex vocal music with multiple voices singing in counterpoint. I mentioned more than once that Luther collaborated with Johann Walter in the publication of polyphonic settings of the German hymns that Luther and his colleagues had been writing during the winter of 1523 to 1524. And in the preface of that hymnal, the one published in Wittenberg, Luther declared that the aim of this anthology of hymns was both educational and aesthetic. Quote, this is very interesting for those of you who teach in the school here. "These songs were arranged in four or five parts to give the young, who should at any rate be trained in music and other fine arts, something to wean them away from love ballads and carnal songs, and to teach them something of value in their place, thus combining the good with the pleasing, as is proper for youth. Nor am I of the opinion that the gospel should destroy and blight all the arts, as some of the pseudo-religious claim. But I would like to see all the arts, especially music, used in the service of him who gave and made them. The four- and five-part music that Luther was championing here was very far from the stereotype drinking song that Luther is supposed to have cherished. Musicologist Quentin Faulkner and others have pointed out that for Luther, quote, complex art music had as much place in the praise of God as simple compositional song, close quote. In his 1538 text, Harmonie di Passione Christi, 1538, Luther writes about the remarkable power of polyphonic musical forms to express the goodness of God. And this is one of my favorite Lutheran passages. Finally, however, when the attempt is made to improve one's natural musical ability, to develop and unfold it completely, we can perceive, astonished, but cannot comprehend, the boundless and perfect wisdom of God revealed in his wonderful gift of music. Outstanding in this art is this, that while one voice continues to sing its cantus firmus, the firm line, the fixed song, like we just heard where the altos were singing that fixed song of the Lord's Prayer tune, while one voice continues to sing its cantus firmus, other voices at the same time cavort about the principal voice in a most wonderful manner with praise and jubilation, adorning the cantus firmus with the most lovely movement. They seem to present a kind of divine dance, so that even those of our day who have only a most limited amount of sentiment and emotion gain the impression that there exists nothing more wonderful and beautiful. Those who are not moved by this are indeed unmusical and deserve to hear some dunghill poet or the music of swine. Tell us what you really think, Martin. Now, as I've tried to demonstrate, many of the melodies that Luther adapted for use as hymns were based on plain chant, on melodies he'd chanted as a monk, the quality of which he still continued to appreciate. But he also realized that the internal meaning of simple melodies was amplified when harmony was added. When complex interaction of multiple voices all engaging the same melody but in different ways could be heard. I always think of polyphony as exploring the ramifications of a melody. The melody has a logic in it that needs to be unfolded, and when a composer takes that melody and plays with it, the Paganini variations, when they turn it upside down and put it in a major key, you learn something about the meaning that's already latent in the original tune. 1524, when those two Lutheran hymnals were first published, they included a single line of music for the congregation to sing, but also included for some of the hymns these more complex polyphonic settings for the church's choir to sing, and we've heard a few of those by Johann Walter last night and tonight. Robin Lever, and I said that I would explain, okay, you've got these single line tunes which the congregation's going to sing, then you have these complex things which the choir, most of the choir was probably made up of kids from the school, the Latin school that the church has sponsored. How do they fit together in the worship service? Here's how Robin Lever explains it. It wasn't the case that the congregation all sang just the unison hymn, and then the elite, egghead, nerdy music guys got off on Sunday afternoon and played around in somebody's living room singing the polyphony. No, that's not what they did. Here's how it worked, Robin Lever. Quote, the first stanza of a hymn would be sung in a strong, unaccompanied unison with the choir supporting the congregation. The second stanza would then be sung by the choir, a cantus firmus chorale motet. And we've heard some of those. The members of the congregation, following along with the text of the stanza being sung, would have the basic chorale melody reinforced in their ears before joining in to sing again the third stanza in unaccompanied unison, and therefore in alteration with the choir until all the stanzas had been sung. If the chorale motet that the congregation heard sung for the intervening stanzas was constructed out of the building blocks of the chorale melody itself, then the essential character of that melody would enter quickly into the common memory of the congregation, close quote. Now, what I find interesting is a similar technique had been used by pre-Reformation composers for the Mass. In that case, a simple plain chant melody would be sung by the choir and clergy for the first stanza, and the stanza, the second stanza would be a polyphonic setting. I've sung motets by Palestrina and Victoria and other Renaissance composers where we chant in plain chant the first stanza and then we sing four or five part harmony in pretty complex form based on that chant that we just sang, and then we come back and sing the chant. Luther had no doubt participated in that, said, hey, I can adapt this, but instead of having just the choir sing plain chant and polyphony, I'm going to have the congregation sing the melody of this new hymn that we're singing, and then have the choir tease out all the ramifications of that melody on the even-numbered stanzas. And as I said, a lot of those melodies were also taken from some of the very plain chant melodies that he had sung as a monk. Luther obviously knew a good thing when he heard it. He and Johann Walter were happy to employ it in the service of the gospel, rightly understood. After all, why should the Pope have all the good music? I want to close actually with a paragraph from someone who became a pope. I think it's appropriate to, I'm not sure what Luther would think. Oh, I'm sure he'd love this now. Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger, when he was still a cardinal, before he became Pope Benedict, has a wonderful essay called On the Theological Basis of Church Music. It's in a book called The Feast of Faith, Approaches to a Theology of the Liturgy, and this is near the end of that essay. And he's contesting the idea that some Catholic theologians had advanced after Vatican II, that really what churches need to do is they need to be really practical and use easy music, that, and they called it even utility music. It's useful music for congregations to sing. Art music doesn't really have a place in churches. It's not democratic enough. Serious, thoughtful, amazingly beautiful music. No, we'll just give the masses, vanilla, generic, the cheap stuff, you might say. I just thought of our Lord changing water into really good wine. Here's the closing paragraph from that essay. A church which only makes use of utility music has fallen for what is in fact useless. She too becomes ineffectual, for her mission is a far higher one. As the Old Testament speaks of the temple, the church is to be the place of glory, and as such, too, the place where mankind's cry of distress is brought to the ear of God. The church must not settle down with what is merely comfortable and serviceable at the parish level. She must arouse the voice of the cosmos and, by glorifying the Creator, elicit the glory of the cosmos itself, making it also glorious, beautiful, habitable, and beloved. I think what he means here, the church must arouse the voice of the cosmos. The metal that made the pipes in this organ, the wood and the catgut that make this, the violins, the brass that makes up trumpets and trombones, that's the stuff of the cosmos that is being aroused to glorify God when the church presents truly glorious music. He goes on to say, next to the saints, The art which the church has produced is the only real apologetic for her history. It is this glory which witnesses to the Lord, not theology's clever explanations for all the terrible things which, lamentably, fill the pages of the church's history. The church is to transform, improve, humanize the world. But how can she do that if at the same time she turns her back on beauty, which is so closely allied to love? For together, beauty and love form the true consolation in this world, bringing it as near as possible to the world of the resurrection. The church must maintain high standards. She must be a place where beauty can be at home. She must lead the struggle for that spiritualization without which the world becomes the first circle of hell. Thus, to ask what is suitable, that is, for worship, must always be the same as asking what is worthy. It must constantly challenge us to seek what is worthy of the Christian's worship. I think Martin Luther could give a resounding amen to Pope Benedict's statement. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, we'll take about a 14 or so minute break. Once again, we have refreshments in the foyer. Please enjoy some of those and let Ken and John go first. And then we'll come back in at around 8 and hear from John Hodges. So let's take a little break.